الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه المجيد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم رجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا. وقال سبحانه وتعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كلما ذكرك الذاكرون وغفل عن ذكرك الغافلون. وبعد, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I think the main talk for today is Hazrat Mufti Sahab's talk. So I'm like the bone of contention in the middle. And we've all come to listen to the fadail and the virtues of this great personality, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Khalifatul Muslimin, Asadullah al-Ghalib, Imam al-Mashariq wal-Maghrib, Syeduna Ali ibn Abi Talib, Karam Allahu Ta'ala Wajhu al-Kareem, Man radiyallahu ta'ala an wa ardah. He is not in need of any introduction. His name speaks for himself. He is the Amir, the leader of the believers. And he is the lion of Allah, the dominant lion of Allah. And he is the Imam of the East and the West. And he is Ali, the son of Abu Talib, radiyallahu ta'ala an. Sayyiduna Ali, as we know, is the son of Abu Talib, who is the uncle, the paternal uncle of our beloved Rasool sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we also know that our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was brought up by his uncle Abu Talib. After Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got married to Sayyidah Khadija, shortly after, Abu Talib and his wife Sayyidah Fatimatu bint Asad gave birth to Sayyiduna Ali radiyallahu ta'ala an. And she named her son Asad. And her father named him Zayd. But both were not decided as to what are we going to name this child. And the child had not opened his eyes. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who was overjoyed that he's had a cousin, he asked for the baby to be passed to him. And when the child was passed to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he opened his eyes. And the first person this child saw was our beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So they said, Muhammad, the nephew of Abu Talib sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what name shall we call him? He said he was born in the house of Allah. His mawlud was the Ka'batul Musharrafa. He was born in the house of Allah, so name him Ali, the lofty one, from the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thus it was decided, his name shall be Ali. A few years later, 5 years later, 6 years later, there was a famine in Makkatul Mukarramah. Abu Talib did not have a lot of wealth. When it so happened that this famine struck, and Abu Talib was incapable of maintaining his household, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his uncle Sayyiduna Abbas, who was only a year older than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or maybe two, they had a discussion. Our uncle brought us up, and now he's finding it difficult. Each one of us should take one of his sons and make life easy for him. Sayyiduna Abbas took one son, and Rasulullah said, I want Ali. So they came to Abu Talib and they said, can we have your children to bring up for you? Thus, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took Ali at the age of 6 into his own home and repaid the favor that Abu Talib done for Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From that age onwards, Sayyidina Ali was brought up in the home of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As a young man, when I was young, much old now, I recall learning that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had four daughters and they grew up, and he had three sons, but they all passed away in their infancy. What if Rasulullah had a son who grew up? How would he be like? How would his tarbiyah be? What would he grow up to become? And soon I found the answer. He would be like Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Because Rasulullah brought up Sayyidina Ali. This is Imam Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, who has been brought up by the tarbiyah of our noble messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we know very well that he's from the very first Muslims, the first young child by the agreement who became Muslim, who gave shahada and witness, was Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. And then his Meccan life is not very well known because he was a young boy. He was a young boy, that's what he was. When he made migration to Madinatul Munawwara, it was then that he had come into his early 20s. Until then he was a young boy. And before the migration that was made, all the Sahaba took permission, and every one of them was given permission by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam to migrate to Medina, with the exception of a few people. Amongst them, of course, was Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an, and Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. When the time for migration came, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam decided to migrate with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an, Rasulullah gave his bed to Sayyidina Ali. Ali, tonight you will sleep in my bed. I will leave, the enemies will come, but tonight you will sleep in my bed. And tomorrow you shall return the goods of all the people who have deposited their trusts with me. And this is to show you the rank of Sayyidina Ali, who gave up his life for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knew very well, the enemy can come and they can attack me and I can be killed at any moment. But he also know, Rasulullah said, tomorrow you're going to return my trusts. So he knew tomorrow is going to come, because this is the word of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It does not take away from the courage and the bravery of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. When morning came and the Quraysh came and attacked the home, they found Sayyidina Ali sleeping in the bed of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What secrets must he have received on that day? Only he and Rasulullah know sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He then makes the migration. His migration was the most difficult hijrah. Halfway through the journey, he was barefoot. Halfway through the journey, he was barefoot when he came to Madinatul Munawwara. And his foot had swollen with a lot of pain, blood. And he came to the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah smiled and was so happy to see Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an come to the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah embraced him, kissed him, sat him down and had his feet treated. At that moment, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was pairing up the Sahaba, the Muhajirun, the immigrants, and the Ansar, the people of Medina. And he starts saying to them, you Muhajir and you Ansari are from today brothers. You will take care of each other like you take care of your brothers. So he paired them all up. Every Muhajir Muslim had a Ansari brother. But when he came to Sayyidina Ali, he said, Ya Rasulullah, who will you pay me up with? Who is going to be my Ansari brother? Rasulullah said, Ali, anta minni wa ana mink. You are from me and I am from you. You are my brother and I am your brother. And this was the honor given to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, that he was called the brother of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nobody else amongst the Sahaba had this fadila to be called Akhu Rasulillah, other than Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, who Rasulullah would say to him, he is my brother. And this is now when Sayyiduna Ali's life starts to grow. He's grown as a man. He wasn't very tall. He wasn't short, but he wasn't a tall man either. But he was strong, extremely strong. He was well built, as we say in our age, and he had an interest for fighting. He had skill for war. He knew how to use the sword very well. It is said that if he would grab people with his hands, people would struggle to breathe thereafter because of the strength this person held. It is now then the Battle of Badr comes, and three of the leading Quraysh come out in the Battle of Badr to fight with the Muslims. So three Sahaba from the Ansar go. And when the Quraysh see who they are, the Quraysh say, we don't want to fight you. You go back. We want to fight our own people. And you had people who were experts at war. Amongst the Arabs, you were considered a youth until you were 40. You weren't even considered a man until you were 40. And we had people amongst the Quraysh who had expertise in war, expertise. One of them was Walid ibn Utbah. He was an expert warrior. It was a difficult fight. But when he stood and the three stood together, Rasulullah then appointed his family members. Ali, stand up. It is your time to fight him. Hamza, stand up. It is for you to fight him. Ubayd ibn al-Harith, stand up. It is for you to go and fight. And when Sayyidina Ali went as a young boy who had never been to war before, never been to war, not known for duel, not known for fighting, although he was extremely strong, imminently, within the first moments, he took his enemy apart and sent him to death. And then he came to assist his uncle, and he also helped in assisting killing the second person. This is when Sayyidina Ali became famous, that this young man knows how to use the sword. Then when they came to the Battle of Uhud, when they were in the Battle of Uhud and the enemies were attacking Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the one defending Rasulullah, one of the people was Sayyiduna Ali ibn Abi Talib. And Rasulullah would say to Ali, Ali, go move them away. One man would drive 20 people away. Then he would come back. And the Prophet would say, they're coming from there. Ali, go on that side. And he would drive 20 people away. A young man who had not been to war before became extremely skilled at war. But we know in the Battle of Uhud, Sayyiduna Hamza became shaheed. And then came some other battles. And amongst the battles that came was the Battle of Khandaq. This is just to show you his strength. Otherwise, when we talk about Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, he is unparalleled in many aspects. He used to weep in the night. It is well reported about Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, in that as strong as he was, that's how soft-hearted he was. He would stand in the night holding his beard and he would say, speaking to himself, O dunya, have you found nobody else to distract? Nobody else to give your lure to, but to me? Am I the only one? Get away from me, O dunya. I give you talaq 3 times. Away from me. This heart is only for Allah. Leave me alone. And he would talk to himself in such a manner, and he would weep and weep and weep until his beard would become wet. This is Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. He was known for his ibadah. He was known for his simplicity. He was a straight person. He did not play politics. This is very well known about him. Even later on when he became Khalifa, it was known about him that he's a man who has straight words. He was of few words. He wouldn't speak much. He was silent. If spoken to, he would answer. If you asked him an ilmi discussion, he'd open an ocean for you. This is from the ilm that he gained. Rasulullah said about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَنَا مَدِينَةُ الْعِلْمِ وَعَلِيٌّ بَابُهَا. I am the city of knowledge, but Ali is its door. This is a fadila that was given to Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. And there is much to say about the ilm of Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. In the Battle of Khandaq, the Battle of the Trench, when the Quraysh gathered many a people and they came to attack the Muslims had built a trench so that they could not come over. But whilst the Quraysh were there on the other side of the trench, one of the people that had come with the Quraysh was a famous warrior in Arabia. His name was Amr ibn Abdiwud. He jumped over the trench and he came over to the side of the Muslims. And when people saw him, he called out, "I am the champion, Amr ibn Abdiwud, and I challenge any one of you to come and fight me. One-on-one duel. Is there a man amongst you?" And none of the Sahaba answered because they were fatigued, they were tired. But they also knew this is Amr ibn Abdiwud, who has never lost a battle. And the only person to stand up and seek permission to go to fight him was Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Rasulullah stopped Sayyiduna Ali. "Ali, sit down, not for you to fight." And then again he challenged out, "Is there no man amongst you? Are you all women?" And again nobody stood up except Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then for the third time he challenged, that, "Do you not want to go Jannah? This is what you talk about, that if you are shaheed, you are martyred, you are killed, you will go to Jannah. Let me make it easy for you. Come to the duel." And again nobody stood up except one young man, Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. It is at this time Rasulullah then said, "Ali, go fight." And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave him his sword, the Dhulfiqar. This is why there is a famous saying, and it is written on the sword of Sayyiduna Ali, that is reported to be his, and it is written in many places, "La fata illa Ali." There is no youth of courage except Ali. "Wa la sayfa illa Dhulfiqar." And there is no sword but the Dhulfiqar, which had two ends at the end. This was the sword of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which Rasulullah gave to him on this day. "Ali, go fight with this." And Rasulullah gave him sallallahu alayhi wasallam his imama and his helmet and his armor. And then when Rasulullah sent him out, Rasulullah made a beautiful dua. And he said, "Ya Allah, in Badr I gave you Ubaidah and he's gone to you. And in Uhud I gave you Hamza and he has gone to you. Now only Ali is left. Ya Allah, do not let him go back to you. Allow him to come back to me. Do not leave me alone." So then when Sayyiduna Ali went, the mubarazah started, this duel started. And Amr ibn Abdiwud said, "Who are you?" He said, "I'm Ali, the son of Abu Talib." So Amr ibn Abdiwud said, "Go back, I don't want to fight you. You are son of a noble man. Your father was a good man. And I don't want your family to cry over you." Sayyiduna Ali in response said, "But I want your family to cry over you." So the battle began. But before the battle began, Sayyiduna Ali gave him conditions and said to him, "I ask you to accept Islam." And Amr ibn Abdiwud said, "Don't talk about such things." Then he said, "Okay, if you don't accept Islam, I give you a second choice. Go back to where you've come from. No fight. Return." And Amr ibn Abdiwud said, "I've only come to fight." And then the third one was, "If you're going to fight, you strike first. I don't strike first. I let you strike first." Amr ibn Abdiwud was so powerful, to show you his strength. It is well known about Amr ibn Abdiwud that he would put, you know, we have leather. Our leather is weak, the leather that we have. The leather socks that you find, very weak. The leather at that time was so thick, very thick. Amr ibn Abdiwud would put his foot on a piece of leather, and you have people on both sides pulling the leather, on one side, pulling the leather. So you'd have a few people pulling the leather from under his foot. They were unable to pull the leather out of the foot, but that the leather would tear. That's his strength. Can you imagine placing leather, thick leather, under your foot, men trying to pull it from under your feet, but they're unable to because of the strength that you have. This man, Amr ibn Abdiwud, when he would ride an animal, he was like a mini giant. When he would ride animals, his feet would almost touch the ground. That's how big he was. He was so big, really literally like a giant, he would eat a sheep alone. That was his daily meal. He had never lost a battle. He would send people to death in the first strike. This was known about him, Amr ibn Abdiwud. He was a champion of Arabia. People would not want to fight this man. This is how strong he was. So when he struck Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, Sayyiduna Ali's strength was such, he kept his shield before him, but his strength was such that he broke the shield and struck the helmet of Syeduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. That was the force that this person had. But the strength of Syeduna Ali was to withhold the strike. Then Syeduna Ali struck. But Syeduna Ali was so skilled that in one strike, he split his body into two. And then he came back to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah was extremely pleased and happy. This made the Quraysh that came over with Amr ibn Abd al-Wud run back towards the people. And then Allah Ta'ala sent the wind that destroyed their camps, and the Ahzab went back where they came from. There was no battle in this battle. There was no fight except the one Mubaraza of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. So his name became more famous. Now when the news reached the sister of Amr ibn Abd al-Wud, she cried. And she cried profusely that my brother has died. How can someone kill the champion of the Arabs? Who can beat this man? Then it was said to her, she asked, who is the one on whose sword he died? Who is this person? And they said to him, it was Ali ibn Abi Talib. And when she heard that it was Ali who killed my brother, she stopped crying. She said, it's an honor to die from the sword of Ali ibn Abi Talib. My brother has died from a courageous man, not from a weak man. It is an honor for us that the one who's killed my brother is a strong man like Ali ibn Abi Talib. That was his strength that was known in his time. There was pride people found in being killed by Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala an. Then later the battle of Khaybar came. That the Muslims went to Khaybar, we know very well. Khaybar was the fortress of the Jews, and they had many fortresses. And the Muslims were able to conquer many, with the exception of the main one. This main fortress was under the control of a Jewish man, a leader, by the name of Marhab. The kalam that Hafiz Qasim Siddiqui read of Sayyid Pir Nasiruddin alayhi rahmah mentioned this. Marhab was killed by the hands of Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. This man was very powerful, and the Muslims were unable to conquer and open this fort. So they came back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam 3 days later. 3 days they tried, and every day they came back. 3 days later, Rasulullah said to them on one evening, tomorrow I'm going to give the raya, the flag, the standard bearer, to the hand of the one who loves Allah and His Messenger, and Allah and His Messenger love him. Victory will come at his hands. And the Sahaba said, on this night, all of us went to sleep hoping tomorrow Rasulullah is going to give the flag in our hands, because we love Allah and His Messenger, and we want Allah and His Messenger to love us. Next morning came, the Sahaba all gathered eager, looking whose name is going to be called out. And Rasulullah said, where is Ali? Where is Ali ibn Abi Talib? They said, ya Rasulullah, he's unwell, he has a sickness in his eye. So he said, bring him to me. So Sayyiduna Ali was brought radiallahu ta'ala and Rasulullah said to him, what is wrong with you? He said, I have a particular illness. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took out his saliva, placed it on his eye, and lo and behold, he could see clearly. Then the Messenger of Allah gave him the flag, said, Ali, go, Allah is with you. So he was the one that the Messenger of Allah had alluded to the night before, the one who Allah loves and His Messenger loves, and he loves Allah and he loves His Messenger. And Sayyiduna Ali went to conquer this fort, and Marhab would not allow the Muslims to enter until Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, it is reported in the books of Tariq that he removed the door of the fort with his bare hands, which later took 40 people to carry. This is the strength of this one man. He pulled out the door of the hinges from the hinges with his bare hands. And then he came to Marhab, and the duel began. And Marhab said, I am Marhab. Khaybar knows who Marhab is. He was a Jew, he spoke about himself, how great a warrior he is. I am the one, if I strike once, my enemy doesn't return, Marhab said. It is at this moment, Sayyiduna Ali said radiallahu ta'ala an, أَنَا الَّذِي سَمَّتْنِي أُمِّي حَيْدَرًا. I am the one whose mother named him a lion. And I am the one that if I'm attacked once, I come back stronger. This is the meaning of Karar. He was then known as Al-Haydar Al-Karar, the lion that continuously, repeatedly attacks back. And then the duel began, and like many before, Sayyidina Imam Ali radiallahu ta'ala an was able to defeat his enemy with one single blow, and Khaybar was then conquered at the hands of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. Much happened thereafter, and much happened in the Khilafah of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. But it is the adab of Ahl Sunnati wal Jama'ah that we do not speak about the differences that occurred between the Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim ajma'in in the life of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. Thus, it is not befitting of myself to speak any further about what happened between him and Sayyidina Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. It is sufficient to know that Sayyidina Ali then became the fourth Khalifa. One beautiful hadith that is not often mentioned, and mentioned often by the Shia, but is a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is on the return of Tabuk, not Tabuk, another battle. On the return of another battle, because to Tabuk Rasulullah, Sayyidina Ali didn't go radiallahu ta'ala an. From the return of another battle, rather it was from the Fath of Makkah and the Hajj, the Fath of Makkah. On the way back, Rasulullah stopped at a well by the name of Ghadir Khum. And when he stopped at Ghadir Khum, Rasulullah said sallallahu alayhi wasallam, do I not have more right over you than yourselves? Alas to be awla minkum, am I not more rightful over you? As Allah says in the Quran, an-nabiyyu awla bil mu'minina min anfusihim. They said, indeed you are, ya Rasulullah, you have more right over us than we have over ourselves. So Rasulullah said, man kuntu mawlahu fahadha aliyun mawlahu. Whoever I am a mawla of, whoever I have more right over, this Ali is his mawla. This is why we call Mawla Ali, Mawla Kainat. Because Sayyidina Rasulullah is the mawla of the Kainat. And Rasulullah makes Sayyidina Ali Mawla Kainat radiallahu ta'ala an. This was sharaf and honor given to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. Misunderstood, of course, by the Shia to mean that this is a khilafah bila fasl given to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. If that be the case, then the very first person to have spoken up that I am the Khalifa as given to me by Rasulullah would have been Mawla Ali himself. And he would not have let the truth go for anything. Yet Mawla Ali radiallahu ta'ala an did not say, I have been appointed as a Khalifa by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam by no chain, not in the chains of the Sunni Islam and not in the chains of the Shia Islam at all. If they bring something, these are fabrications. And this is a very well known documented fact. Mawla Ali radiallahu ta'ala an did consider himself a worthy candidate, but never said on his tongue, I have been appointed Khalifa by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And to then believe, after speaking about his bravery, that Mawla Ali, who is a lion, Asadullah, the name given to him by Rasulullah after the Fath of Khaybar, he was called Asadullah, the lion of Allah, by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, would remain silent after Rasulullah had said to him, you are the Khalifa after me. This is not the case and never was the case. Rather, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an became the rightful fourth Khalifa. There was immense love between him and Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an, and immense love between him and Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab. He gave his daughter in hand to Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab. That these narrations are well known. Whether someone rejects them today from Shia Islam or Sunni Islam makes no difference. It's documented in Tariq that he gave his daughter Sayyidina Kulthum to Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. And Sayyidina Umar came out in Medina and said to people, congratulate me. Today I have nasab with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. On that day when all nasab will come to an end on Yawm al-Qiyamah, my nasab will remain with Rasulullah because his nasab will remain sallallahu alayhi wa sallama. Then later, of course, in the khilafah of Sayyidina Uthman, Sayyidina Ali took a back step and did not get involved in the politics and avoided people. On the martyr of Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an, the khalifa of the Muslims, we also know that the two people who were guarding the house of Sayyidina Uthman were none other than Imam Hassan and Imam Hussain radiallahu ta'ala an. You don't place your children in front of the house of a person that you do not like to be defended. Rather, you only put your children where you love them to be. and he loved Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu ta'ala, and political differences of course happened with all people. Then Sayyidina Ali of course became the Khalifa for 4 years and approximately 5 or 6 months and a certain number of days. It was the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that from the day he became an Amir, he did not see a day of peace. This is the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did not see a day of peace. The dunya was never for the Ahl al-Bayt. Jannah is for the Ahl al-Bayt. The sons of Rasulullah are the leaders of the youth of Jannah. You want to enter Jannah, you have to come under the siyada of Imam Hassan and Imam Hussain radiallahu ta'ala an. This is the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Later in life, in his khilafah, during his khilafah, somebody asked him, why is it Ali, he was from the Khawarij, why is it that in the lifetime of Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, things were good? But in your lifetime, from the time you've come, there's been difficulty. Why? Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala was known for his intelligence. He said, because Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Ali, Sayyidina Uthman had me as an advisor and I have you. This is Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala. He was known as the most wise of the Sahaba. Aqdahum Ali. The words of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala an. Sayyidina Umar would not make a judgment without Mawla Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. And the last thing, inshallah, because I'd like Mufti Sahib to speak and I've taken a lot of time. His intelligence, to show you his intelligence, extremely intelligent man. Two people happened to be traveling and they ate together. They had, the first person had 5 loaves of bread and the second person had 3 loaves of bread. Then whilst they were about to eat, another person came, a traveler, who had no food. So they all ate together. After eating, that third person gave them both 8 dinar. He said, have these 8 dinar. When that person left, the two people now started a dispute. The first of them said, the one who had 5 loaves, 5 dinar for me, 3 dinar for you. Whilst the one who had 3 said, no, he took half of yours, half of mine, so 4 dinar for you, 4 dinar for me. So they brought it to Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. They presented the case. So Sayyidina Ali said to the one who had 3 loaves, take his offer. If he's giving you 3, take it, it's better for you. He said, no, ya Ali, I want haqq, I want adal. So Sayyidina Ali said, fine, the adal is the following. This is his intelligence. That he had 5 loaves, you had 3. So there's 8 loaves altogether, but there are 3 of you. So we can't divide 8 loaves into 3. So we have to divide every loaf of bread into 3. So now we've got 24 loaves of bread. 24 loaves. And we have to assume all of you ate equally. That means all of you ate 8 loaves each. You have to follow me in a bit of maths there. Okay? 3 divided into 8 loaves divided into 3, cut into 3, so there's 24 loaves, 3 people, we assume you ate equally, 8 loaves each. Sayyidina Ali said you had 3 pieces of bread, that's 9 loaves. That means you ate 8 of yours, and the traveler ate 1 of yours. As for the one of the 5, he had 5 loaves of bread, which equals to 15 loaves, 15 parts, 5 times 3. He ate his 8, and the traveler ate 7 of his 15. This means the adal insaf would be, he takes 7 dinar, you take 1. This is the intelligence of Mawla Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. And there's many more examples of the mathematics, the sharpness, the wisdom of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. With these words, I conclude, may Allah ta'ala elevate the rank of Sayyidina Ali. Sayyidina Imam Shafi'i used to say, if loving Ali al al-Bayt is Shi'aism, fa'ana Shi'i. I am Shia, because we love Mawla Ali radiallahu ta'ala an. It has never been the case that Sunni Islam was shy to say we are muhibban of Ahl al-Bayt, and we are muhibban of Mawla Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, and we are muhibban of Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein, because these are who our Imams are. Most definitely, it's like a hijack that has taken place. Khair, if they love Mawla Ali, it's good for them, they benefit. If they're going to ghulu, it's bad for them. Mawla Ali is free from them. Like we have people hijacked Islam, like ISIS. We have people who hijack Ahl al-Bayt. We have to take Islam back, and we have to take Ahl al-Bayt back. Barakallahu feekum, wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahim, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wa afdalu salati wa atammu tasleem.